So good evening and a warm welcome back to another session of this series of Meeting an Expert. As Asia Pacific Institute of Information Technology, we are honored to host this webinar today with the presence of many experts and talking about very, very valuable inputs, which includes life sharing experiences as well. So I would like to warmly welcome all our students who are in the platform today, and all our students and the staff members who are joining from our partner universities, and of course all the foreign delegates and diplomats who are joining us today from all around the world, along with our special guests. And to start with our sessions for the day, I would like to invite our chairman, Mr. Bandula Egodege, to share his expressions and wishes. Chairman, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Kaushali. First of all, I have to say big thank you for Excellency, the Grace Sasaratham, for, in spite of a busy schedule, accepting our invitation, especially the great initiative done by Dr. Rohan Tatukorala, for being with us today as our chief guest. So very warmly welcome you, madam, on behalf of our CEO, Mr. Roshan Egodege, and entire students' population, and our board of directors, and also the lecturers, and the people who are joining with us today from various destinations, ambassadors, and many people who are joining us. So I once again wish to welcome you, and also thanking you for being with us today, the great event. Madam Excellency, APIT, I think I don't need to explain you that an APIT known as a quality education institute, but we want to make that, you know, not only the academic excellence, our entire effort is to make sure, in addition to the academic excellence, all those people who are passing out from our institute has to be future leaders. So therefore, they have to be updated with current affairs, and also with them, they have to build their own leadership skills to come to the society in the near future. This great initiative, as I said, done by Dr. Rohan Tatukorala, we brought many opinion leaders like you. Whole objective is to get the direct interaction for our students as well as our viewers to get experience, the personality like you all, to have better knowledge enhancement for their lives. I think apart from you, madam, we have a very, excellent panel joining us, Mr. Mahen Karyavasam and Mr. Ravi Jayawardhan. Also, I just heard that Director NC, Madam Menaka, also being with us today. So thank you very much for that. What we do, basically, again, all our students, we will fulfill their needs, the satisfaction, while making our parents' aspirations. So that's the all about APIT. And also, everybody, welcome for this seminar. And I request all my students to get the maximum use of Madam Excellency Grace Asivadam, and send their any questions or anything to her and the great panel. So once again, thank you, madam. Thank you very much. Over to you, Kaushali.
Thank you very much, Chairman. And that was Bandula Egodege, former chairman of Sri Lanka Export Development Board. He's the chairman of the Industrial Association of Sri Lanka, Vice President Nestle. Thank you very much for that welcome address. And may I take the liberty of introducing our panel. Our panel is Mr. Karyavasam, Mahen Karyavasam, known personality in the tourism industry. He's the president of Sri Lanka Benelux Business Council. Then we have Ravi Jayawardhana, the president of the National Chamber of Exporters, NCE. And of course, we have Madam Ambassador. Before I hand over the mantle to our keynote speaker today, can I invite Menaka Vanyarachi, the director of the National Chamber of Exporters, the only export chamber in Sri Lanka. Menaka, over to you.
Thank you, Rohantha. Her Excellency, the Ambassador, Mr. Mahen Karyavasan, Mr. Jayawardhana, and Mr. Bandula Egodege, good evening to all of you. National Chamber of Exporters of Sri Lanka is pleased to join this webinar organized by Sri Lanka Benelux Business Council, and of course, together with the Asia Pacific Institute. To talk about the chamber, NC is the exclusive business chamber in Sri Lanka, representing exporters. So we provide, among many services that we provide to our member exporters, some of them are advocacy for improving trade, creating market access opportunities, and also clarifying, certifying ethical trading practices. And also we attest export documentation, we have publications in exports, and of course, we are celebrating export performance in international market through our annual export awards. When it comes to creating market access opportunities, we conduct many webinars in association, in coordination with Sri Lankan foreign missions. Her Excellency, Mrs. Grace Asirvadam herself was the main speaker at a webinar where we conducted with the EU Embassy in October last year under underutilization of GSP Plus. So likewise, we conduct many webinars with various stakeholders for the common benefit of our member exporters. Of course, we are looking forward to work together with y'all, including Benelux Business Council, where we can join hands in supporting exporters of Sri Lanka. Thank you very much. Over to you, Rohanta.
Thank you very much. And I just like to acknowledge our partners today, which is the Daily Financial Times and the National Chamber of Exporters, and of course, the Sri Lanka Benelux Business Council. So we have with us the Ambassador Grace Asirvadan, is a senior member of the Sri Lanka Foreign Service with 33 years of service. Currently, she serves as the Ambassador of Sri Lanka to Belgium, Luxembourg, and the Head of Mission to the European Union. Prior to that, she served as the Secretary to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Ambassador Asirvadam also served as Sri Lanka's ambassador to Nepal and Netherlands. She held several senior positions in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Colombo, as well as served in Sri Lankan missions in Germany and Pakistan. As an international civil servant, Ambassador Asirvadam held positions of Deputy Director General with the rank of UN Assistant General in the Organization for Prohibition of Chemical Weapons from 2011 to 2015. Ambassador Asirvadam holds a Bachelor of Science degree in Business Administration, University of Jaffna, and an MA in International Relations, University of Colombo. Ladies and gentlemen, the Ambassador for Sri Lanka to Belgium, Luxembourg, and the Head of Mission to the European Union, Grace Asirvadam. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rohanta, for that introduction. At the same time, I want to correct my previous position. I was Secretary to the State Ministry of Foreign Affairs. With that, at the outset, let me thank the Asia Pacific Institute of Information Technology and the Benelux Business Council and also National Chamber of Exporters for organizing this webinar on building business with the EU. What makes EU an important market? This is the question that we are going to answer today. It is important simply because the EU is the largest single market in the world, with 27 countries and more than 447 million consumers. The successful regional integration of the European countries as the European Union gives the resources to the EU for their collective prosperity, world political image, and strength as a political power. Protection of human rights is one of the EU's overarching objectives in its external action, in line with the Treaty of European Union. One of the main tools of the EU to promote human rights in third countries is the Generalized Scheme of Preferences, GSP, granting certain developing countries preferential trade access to the EU market. As you know, there are three types of beneficiary schemes under the GSP regulation. in addition to the GSP Plus, there's a standard GSP scheme extended to developing countries in the lower income category, for which tariff reduction is given on certain products. And another scheme given to LDCs is Everything But Arms, EBA scheme, which gives zero tariff on all products except the arms. The trade relations between the EU and Sri Lanka are guided by a partnership and cooperation agreement that entered into force in April 1995. The main trade policy instrument governing trade between the EU and Sri Lanka is GSP Plus, under which Sri Lanka could benefit from over 7,000 product lines at zero duty. This is the key incentive which we enjoy under the GSP Plus. The EU offers the GSP Plus facility as a special incentive arrangement for sustainable development and good governance. As part of the conditions, Sri Lanka assumed the responsibility to ratify and implement 27 co-international conventions on human rights, labor rights, environmental protection, and good governance, and also to cooperate with the Commission to monitor implementation of these conventions. The EU has been Sri Lanka's second largest export partner since 2020, with around 21.4% of Sri Lanka's exports to the world being sent to the EU. The balance of trade between the two parties has been in favor of Sri Lanka during the last several years. Our total trade is in the region of 4.5 billion, of which our exports to the EU were 3 billion, and imports were 1.5 billion. The major importers are Germany, Italy, Belgium, Netherlands, France, Austria, Spain, Sweden, and Poland. Also, major export items of Sri Lanka to the EU under GSP Plus are apparel items. Apparel items constitute more than 60% of our exports to the EU. And then we have rubber and articles thereof, tea and spices, fish and fish products, electrical machinery and equipment parts, tobacco and manufactured tobacco, and miscellaneous edible preparations, natural colored stones, etc. GSP Plus deals with trade in goods only. Services and investments are not included. Services and investments will have to be promoted on bilateral basis between Sri Lanka and the respective EU member countries. Under the EU FTAs, in addition to trade, there are provisions for investment and services. However, since we are conducting our trade relations based on GSP Plus, we have no access to such facilities at the moment. While the EU's GSP regulation provides tariff concessions, there are several regulations and legal instruments governing the subject of export of goods to the EU. There are common regulations applicable to all third countries. When doing business with the EU, the exporters should be knowledgeable or should be aware about the associated rules and regulations which are in place in the EU system to control unfair trade practices. Some of the major regulations are, the first one is rules of origin regulation. If you want to obtain originating status and to qualify under rules of origin criteria in order to benefit GSP plus benefits, a product must be either wholly obtained or sufficiently worked or processed in the exporting country. However, there are exemptions such as cumulation arrangements, certain cumulation arrangements. The basic rule is to import the required materials from the countries which are permitted by the Commission. And these materials should be incorporated into a product being manufactured in Sri Lanka or in a third country. And it should be well processed beyond simple handling or processing. And the accumulation arrangements, I think we should also go into that, that there are four types of accumulation arrangements. One is bilateral accumulation arrangement. It's an easy one. You can get those materials, accessories, spare parts, or whatever you require for your manufacturing in your country. You can import such items from the EU countries, where you don't need to get any special permissions. And then we have regional accumulation. Under the GSP arrangement, they have four groups, regional groups. Within this group, you can get your materials required for manufacturing and production. So Sri Lanka, being in the SAARC region, within SAARC region, we will be able to import raw materials from those countries, provided they give you the origin document. It should be supported by the supply country's origin document, rules of origin document. And then cross-regional. Cross-regional means you can, from SAARC region, you can import from ASEAN region, for which you need to get prior approval from the Commission. This is very important. There are possibilities according to the regulation, but there are conditions attached to it. And then we have extended accumulation. Extended accumulation, under extended accumulation, a country can import raw materials required from another country with which the EU has FTA arrangement. So these are the countries permitted for us to do accumulation. And the next arrangement or the regulation is anti-dumping and countervailing duties legislation. The Commission will initiate an anti-dumping investigation on complaints with sufficient evidence that a non-EU country is exporting products to the EU at a price lower than the normal value of the product. And if proved, that country will have to pay anti-dumping duties. Then we have rules on illegal, unreported, and unregulated IUU fishing. This is very important for Sri Lanka. If a GSP beneficiary country is found to be violating or breaching the IUU laws, the EU will take punitive measures to the extent of slapping a ban on imports from that country, especially the fish and fisheries products. And we also have anti-circumvention measures, where if you try to circumvent the regulation and the payments, then you will be under investigation. Your products will also be under scrutiny at this end. And most importantly, we will have to study the provisions and stipulations under the health and safety laws. Health and food safety laws. The Director General of Health and Food Safety of the European Commission has a rapid alert system to ensure health and safety of consumer products. If there are certain violations related to certifications or standards, or any discrepancies for that matter, and presence of prohibited and prohibited substances exceeding and also exceeding maximum level of residual of pesticides will create problem for our consignments, export consignments. Even if they fail to detect any such substances, harmful substances in the food items, they will recall such items from the markets. And they will inform the member countries. And they can also reject the consignment at the entry points, at the ports, and then they will issue notifications and they will work with the authorities to correct, address this situation. And such products will come under observation. That's a lengthy procedure. Unless we do, unless we take measures to address such problems, then they will not allow such products from that particular company or particular country into the EU. And also under the Directorate of Health and Food Safety, we have sanitary and phytosanitary rules. It's called aerophyte notification, especially on consignments of plants and plant products, such as fruits and vegetables imported into the EU for not complying with health standards in force. If harmful organisms are found in the consignments, in the products, these consignments will be rejected. And they will not tolerate such consignments continuously breaching or violating the rules. So there's a procedure before they ban such items into the market, EU market. And they will always engage in dialogue. They will give you sufficient time. They will issue notifications. So we will have to take the flexibility in the procedures to our advantage and correct those shortcomings. And GSP does not exempt its beneficiaries from the application of these instruments. GSP's scheme is separate and the regular rules are separate. All will have to go through, all will have to abide by those general legal instruments governing the imports into the EU region. As you are aware, Sri Lanka reached the upper middle income classification by the World Bank in 2019. However, we could not sustain it. You all know that. And we have come back to the lower middle income category into 2020. Due to severe impact of COVID-19 on the economy, we have to wait and see when we will be able to reach the upper middle income again. In other words, it gives Sri Lanka more time as a lower middle income country to continue to benefit from the GSP plus tariff concessions. As the government of Sri Lanka has negotiated with the EU, the specialized incentive trade arrangement, undertaking to fulfill the conditions that came along as part of the GSP plus criteria and secured the GSP plus benefits to Sri Lanka and continue to be engaged with the EU in a dialogue to sustain and maintain the grant of GSP plus benefits for the country, the business community should focus on maximizing the use of these facilities. This is very important. government has done so much to get this regained, maintain it, fulfilling the conditions, but the utilization level has to be improved. The business community should maximize the utilization of the GSP plus tariffs given to Sri Lanka, because the utilization level is only 62% at the moment. Other GSP plus beneficiary countries are utilizing the tariffs given to them over 90%. So we should use this opportunity to establish ourselves in the EU market as a viable trade community and create a name for Sri Lankan products in terms of quality and ethical and environmentally friendly production and manufacturing practices. These are very important. We need to increase the volume of the current exports to benefit from zero duty under GSP plus. We should also expand our product base or product basket, our exports to the EU. 7,000 product lines are given under zero tariff. I'm repeating this. We need to encourage and promote potential new products that have market demand in the EU and that could be developed or produced in Sri Lanka. Further, Sri Lanka should also find new markets within the 27 countries. Sri Lanka continues to export to some major countries, major markets in the region. We need to look at the market opportunities in other EU countries, including non-EU countries such as Norway, Turkey, and Switzerland, which have special trade arrangements with the EU. Export product promotion is most essential as an activity to get more contacts with importers and get more supply orders and expand markets for Sri Lankan products. Market survey is also very important to gauge the trend in the EU. While focusing on the present pandemic situation, we need to align ourselves with the trending of new consumer preferences, behaviors, changing quality standards and expectations. With the vigorous vaccination drive, the COVID-19 pandemic situation across the world is slowly yet steadily improving, regardless of the new challenges. As a result, the world is revolving around a new normal, unwritten order for economic recovery and to conduct business and to move forward. The EU region is accelerating its realization of green concepts and developing green EU Green Deal policies, broadening its perspective of organic vision beyond food and feed to raw materials in productions and manufacturing practices, and focus on areas of waste management, environmental pollution by industrial waste, etc. This is a subject of an ongoing discussion within the EU, and we will hear more on the Green Deal based decisions and regulations in the near future. While the world is adapting itself to green practices, Sri Lanka should also be proud of its own plan of action to keep pace with the global trend. Sri Lanka is the world's most ethical sourcing destination, particularly for apparel. Our motto is garment without guilt. Sri Lanka has strong potential to enhance its external trade performance, since our brands are increasingly associated with high quality and ethical manufacturing practices, focusing on green concept, environmental safeguards and practices, and targeting zero child labor through pioneering child labor free zones. These are very important reasons that we could present along with our promotion and arguments to present our products, especially apparel products, in the market. Further, we are building an environmentally friendly fabric zone and pushing for more green energy and better waste management. We need to ensure all companies can take advantage of green credentials when selling overseas. And then organic farming is a fast growing interest in the EU agriculture, which is a direct result of increased consumer interest in organic products. There is a growing market for fair trade certified products in the EU market. This embassy, in collaboration with the Fair Trade Advocacy Office, Belgium Fair Trade Federation, and also the Trade Development Center, we are promoting exports of fair trade certified products from Sri Lanka in a small scale. The items that we have already promoted are toys, masks, zero waste products, gift items, and many other products are being promoted, and we are promoting certification of fair trade by Sri Lanka and also in this region. We are also negotiating a framework agreement for cooperation with Fair Trade Advocacy in Belgium, together with the support of the EU, to develop fair trade concept and also industry in Sri Lanka. This will be very helpful for Sri Lanka to focus on fair trade with this capacity building support and other market related support from the EU and the advocacy in Belgium. COVID-19 has led to a surge in e-commerce and accelerated digital transformation businesses. And the consumers have increasingly gone digital during the pandemic. They are still continuing it, although they have almost come out of the pandemic situation. It is continuing. They provided and also purchased more goods and services online. Hence, it serves companies to invest in online platforms to reach more customers. The pandemic-led digital transformation made a major shift towards online and mobile banking as an easy, hygienic alternative to cash. This has become very popular among the European customers. Sri Lanka should also study the digital options, global marketplaces, creating e-com sites, developing digital products, etc. In conclusion, I would like to say that we are surrounded by several powerful Asian countries with developed technology and resources. Some countries have bilateral trade arrangements with the EU, including FTAs. Some have negotiated geographical identification, GI status, for several of their products. As you know, the GI recognition enables consumers to trust and distinguish quality products, while also helping producers to market their products better. Under this setting in Asia, Sri Lanka has been exporting to the EU only around 3.5 billion worth of products. Sri Lanka can increase the exports, for which the Sri Lankan exporters to be more competitive. Their products should be more competitive. They should be focusing on producing and manufacturing practices strictly in compliance with the trade legal arrangements at this end. And constantly they should be promoting their products in EU capitals effectively with new strategies and also innovative ideas for branding, and also to apply for GI status for unique Sri Lankan products. Keep modifying the products as per the changing consumer behaviors. Maintain quality and improve packaging. We need to follow the market evolution and trend in Europe as part of our preparation to get our share of future market opportunities in the EU. I thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador to Sri Lanka, to Belgium, Luxembourg, head of the mission to the European Union, and former secretary to the State Ministry of Foreign Affairs. I mean, my mind went back to the days I was chairman of the Export Development Board, madam. And, you know, the thoughts you shared is so relevant. Number one, ethically manufactured products that we have. We are the most compliant when it comes to apparel. In fact, we are termed the first ethically sourced apparel industry in the world. Number two, we are the first ethically manufactured tea endorsed by the Kyoto Protocol. I remember my days at the tea board for 10 years. We did this work and it was a total private-public partnership. I like the whole concept of GI registration and certification status, which actually Sinon Cinnamon enjoys. And in fact, we are so different to Cassia, which comes from competitors. And then of course, we have this beautiful Ceylon Sapphire. So I think very, very market-driven presentation. To my mind, Madam is not actually an ambassador. Madam is a marketing professional who is totally focused to understanding the trends in Europe and telling us how we need to be compliant with them. And that's how you go and capture markets. I'd like to invite Mr. Mahen Karivasan, the President of Sri Lanka Benelux Business Council, a very renowned tourism expert, former president of SLITO, who will give a view of the tourism. Mahen, over to you.
Thank you, Rohanta. Your Excellency, Dr. Rohanta, and members of the panel, thank you very much for giving us an opportunity to say a few words about my business council. The Benelux Business Council started in 1992 and is affiliated to the Ceylon Chamber of Commerce. Our main aim is to promote trade and tourism. So I think this is an excellent opportunity for us to exchange ideas and going forward. I think tourism plays a key role in the EU. And with the new norm and the new problems that we've been having with the COVID, I think the way the people are going to travel in the future are going to change. So we have to be ready for that. At the moment, unfortunately, we don't have much tourism out of the EU due to the various health issues and we being in the red list. But having said that, Sri Lanka, we are open for tourism. We have done some health protocols. We're trying to make it more flexible as we go on. It's also a learning curve for all of us. So as of yesterday, we have also opened up for tourists to stay up to 180 days visa online. So which was also, I think, a great thing for especially to attract the digital nomads who wants to come and work in Sri Lanka or do some work out of Sri Lanka. So I think this is a new concept we are looking at. Apart from that, the health protocols now a little bit more flexible than it was at the beginning, where we encourage fully vaccinated tourists to come in and do a PCR test once they get into Sri Lanka. And after the result is out, they can travel in the community and to any other areas that they want in Sri Lanka. Of course, if we have a non-vaccinated tourist coming in, they have to remain within the bio bubble. There again, after the first PCR, there are some steps and they have to remain, but they can travel in the country. They can see all the tourist sites. All the sites are open at the moment. And they can go back if they want after 14 days into the society after doing another PCR and having a negative test. All the tourists that come in are covered by insurance. It's a compulsory insurance that everyone has to take. And also for the PCR, they have to pay around $40 per PCR. So there is no cost to the government. Even if they fall sick, the insurance takes over. All the staff working in the DMC and also in the hotel are protected, are vaccinated, fully vaccinated. And also they are issued coming under a safe and secure license. So there is very, very low possibility of transmission of COVID to the local community. And at the moment, out of about 17,000 clients we have had since January, we have had a very, very less than 1% of the clients who have had COVID infection, and which has not gone into our society, which has been very well controlled. So I think people also, there's a negative perception among the Sri Lankan people about tourism, that the tourists are bringing in COVID. I think we have to educate them to get out of this perception and move forward, because tourism is a very important industry to the economy of Sri Lanka. We bring in a good year, approximately $4.5 billion, and 95% of this money remains in the country, unlike any other industry. So it's a very important industry for the economy. So, and also we employ direct and indirect about 3 million people. And that's also quite important for the people. So once again, I think I just covered it very briefly. If somebody has any questions, we can on the Q&A, we can talk about it. So thank you very much, Rohantha and Excellency, and EPIT also, for giving us this opportunity to come and make a small presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mayan. Really appreciate for the very succinct thoughts that were shared. And it's, I think, I remember the days how we used to go all over the world promoting brand tourism and the amazing respect that countries have for you. And I think you're very important to see us through this new phase that we are in to regain the share. A whole heap of questions are coming across, but before I open the house for Q&A, can I invite the President of the National Chamber of Exporters, Mr. Ravi Jayawardhana. Sir, over to you.
Stuti Rohantha, Aibowan, Subha Sandhava, Kali Varankangal, good evening. Thana Patitumiani, Kathika Manle Samajika Maturuni, Mitra Varuni. අද මාතෘකාව වන යුරෝපා සංගමයේ සමග ව්‍යාපාර ගොඩනැගීම ඉතාමත්ම කාලෝචිත කරුණක් යයි මා විශ්වාස කරනවා. මක්නිසාදයක් දැනට පවත්නා මනාප සාමාන්‍යකරණ පද්ධතිය ධන පහසුකම යම්කිසි අවස්ථාවකදී ලංකාවට අහිමි වීමේ ලකුණු පහළ වී ඇත. ශ්‍රී ලංකා ජාතික අපනයනකරුවන්ගේ මණ්ඩලයේ වත්මන් සභාපති ලෙසටත් 1977 සිට අපනයන ශ්‍රේෂ්ත්‍රයේ නියැලි පුද්ගලයෙක් ලෙසත් කිසියම් අදහසක් මේ අවස්ථාවේ පළ කිරීමට ලැබීම ගැන මා ඉතාමත්ම සතුටුයි. Ladies and gentlemen, it has been a task for all exporters when dealing with the European Union. We have had the opportunity of having the GSP, then move into a GSP plus, then lose the GSP plus and re-get it. But somehow or other, with all these time, the exporters have survived to some extent and done their duty. Madam Ambassador, you touched on a very important subject, and I believe Rohantha also, you also touched on it, about fair trade. I'm very proud to say that the National Chamber of Exporters of Sri Lanka is the only trade chamber in Sri Lanka that issues ethical trading certification. We have form the 8 principles of internationally recognized trade practices as benchmark and are now in the process of awarding such certifications to Sri Lankan enterprises. So this is a unique situation and a unique opportunity for Sri Lankan enterprises to obtain this certification, because as the Madam Ambassador said, getting business in Europe, this fair trade or ethical trading opens up lots of avenues. So with that, Rohanta, I am being entrusted with 3 minutes of time, so I'm not going to dwell anymore, and I'm sure there are going to be 101 questions, so I am ready for questions. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Ravi, and sincerely appreciate the key point which you mentioned of the fair trade. The fair trade market is really picking up, and one key thing we have realized the pandemic has done is that people are staying at home and they're asking themselves, you know, what is our purpose in life? And they're going back to the roots of behavior. They are using Ayurvedic products. They're going back to traditional ways of living. And I suppose, you know, we are just gone back in time, which is actually making a lot of us very healthy. So your initiative of fair trade is very, very opportune. And I suppose this is the same kinds of policies that Madam was sharing with us, that we need to start advocating so that we can get higher share in Europe. Let me turn towards Her Excellency. And ma'am, the first question that's coming in from Lasanta De Silva. He's an MBA graduate of Staffordshire University. He's attached to Kotagala Plantations, and he's saying, what help do you want from private sector in Sri Lanka to develop trade with EU?
Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, thank you very much. Now, as the ambassador to Belgium and Luxembourg and also to the European Union, and also I served as ambassador in other places, we always wanted the support of the private sector. And the private sector should stay together as a community and come together under sector basis, despite their own business competitions, to understand the opportunities and challenges, and also to have the required strategies in place to guide the exporters in Sri Lanka as well. And then also they should understand the EU regulatory requirements, which is key to export success in the EU. And the private sector should also understand the benefits under the GSP Plus and follow the EU rules and other associated legal instruments. And we want the private sector to focus on product promotion, product diversification, and also market diversification. You join with the global value chain, expand the product basket to include more innovative products. It's very important. Needless to say that export promotion is crucial in the competitive business world to retain the market demands and also to create new demands. Constant promotional activities are important. If your physical participation is not possible at promotional events, you provide the resources to the missions abroad for us to engage in such activities. And the private sector should also support the missions abroad in overall trade promotion activities, matchmaking, B2B meetings, and also to participate in trade fairs. Trade fairs are very important for promoting business, especially in the EU region. They should provide updated and detailed company profiles and relevant information, and electronic presentations, brochures, and promotional material and product samples wherever possible. They have to give these things to the mission. And they should also maintain websites with up-to-date product details, contact information, and standard certificates. we should be able to communicate with the relevant authorities in Sri Lanka to obtain necessary guidelines, standards to guide the exporters before they export new products, especially new products to the EU. Yeah, there are SME sectors and new startups, they all want to do business with the EU, but there should be some authorities properly guiding them. And we have to improve quality of packaging and labeling. And you have to adhere to EU regulation on packaging and labeling. And we should not misuse the opportunities by exporting non-originated products, violating rules of origin rules, and also not to involve in countervailing activities to circumvent EU regulations. These are bad practices. It is not only affecting you personally, not only your company, the country's image will also be tarnished. And even other exporters will have problem in exporting the same items. And extend your cooperation to minimize the number of consignments being rejected due to disqualifying with EU standards. And also export with all the required certificates according to the EU standards. If you do that, we can do the rest. We can chase targets. We can arrange B2B meetings. We can arrange matchmaking events. We have been doing, even during COVID situation, from the last 1.5 years, we have been doing that. The embassy can connect, but you have to follow the rules. Thank you.
Thank you very much, madam. That's a very important point you mentioned. You know, I was just doing a bit of research and it showed that there's a huge exhibition coming up, I think, in Belgium in the next 1 or 2 months. Will there be a trend to some products where demand from EU will keep increasing in the next 2 years?
Yes, European consumers are showing an increased interest in sustainable and organic products, herbal products, sugar-free natural products, and they are more health conscious now. They want health products which are produced under decent working and living conditions with more transparency throughout the supply chains. At the same time, demand for our regular export items such as apparel, rubber products, fish and fish products, tea, spices, even coconut and coconut products, and many other items will continue to increase. It will not stop. It will continue to increase. And therefore, Sri Lanka may focus on niche products, circular economy products, value-added products, zero-waste products, and also recycled products, etc. You need to see the trend in Europe, what is happening in trend, how the COVID has changed the consumer behaviors, and what is the kind of future that we are going to have here in terms of exports. So this is what we have to observe. Thank you.
There's a question coming from Guy Anthony. He's on the MBA program at Staffordshire, and he's saying, given that UK is no more in the EU, what impact has this on the trade with the EU? Very, very interesting question.
Yeah, the United Kingdom left the European Union on 31st January 2020, after 47 years of EU membership. And now it has become a third country to the EU in accordance with their withdrawal agreement. The UK used to be the main importer of Sri Lankan products amongst the 28 EU member countries at the time. And of our exports to the EU, almost 24% of our exports to the EU went to the UK. Before Brexit, the EU had been the largest major export destination for Sri Lanka. And our export size was 29.8% of total exports of Sri Lanka to the world came to the EU, of which, of that, 8.4% was exported to the UK. After Brexit, Sri Lanka's trade to the EU has become 21.4%. This is minus 8.4%, which made the USA as the largest export partner now, with 26.3% of exports going to the US from Sri Lanka. And EU is the second largest export destination for Sri Lanka. And as I said, we export 3 billion worth of products to the EU. Of the euro, 3,035 million worth of exports to the EU in 2019, around 737 million worth of products exported to the UK. Of which, this is very important, of which 65% of the products enjoyed GSP plus tariff concessions. 737 million went to UK, euro, of which 65, not all of them will enjoy GSP plus tariff benefits. Of that, 65% only. After Brexit, we understand that UK has agreed to provide similar tariff concessions, like the GSP plus, similar to the GSP plus. Therefore, we don't see any loss of trade or tariffs for Sri Lankan exports to the EU or the UK. It's the change of statistics. So we need to check the Sri Lanka-UK trade statistics to establish how much the trade has been changed because of Brexit, whether we have lost or whether we continue to receive such benefits. Thank you.
Ma'am, there is continuous questions coming from this. I don't mean to put you on the spot. Dilini, who works for MAS, she's on a master's program, second year at working for MAS, and she's saying the media is reporting that there'll be ramifications on trade with EU due to the GSP issue. What is your view on this, Your Excellency?
Since the questions are coming from students, I will explain it rather than saying yes or no. Since Sri Lanka regained GSP Plus in 2017, the GSP Plus monitoring mission visited Sri Lanka in 2017 and 2019, and they were to visit in 2020. However, due to COVID situation, they couldn't visit. The monitoring mission, after they have visited Sri Lanka in 2017 and 2019, they reported back to the commission, but they didn't raise any serious concern about the implementation of the 27 conventions. Further, EU-Sri Lanka Joint Commission met on an annual basis. Even during COVID time, we met, the bilateral joint commission met. The last meeting was in March 2021. The monitoring mission and the working group on human rights, we have couple of working groups also with the EU. So the working group on human rights and good governance will be hosted in Colombo in September this year. So the mission, monitoring mission, will be there, and the working group on human rights will also meet back to back. So this is going to happen. The mechanism is working very well, with constant dialogue between the two parties, between the EU and Sri Lanka. And the EU appreciated the good cooperation that they have been receiving from the authorities in Sri Lanka. In this regard, I should also mention, because the question is going somewhere where I have to establish something for the students to understand. In this regard, I should also mention that about the status of the resolution adopted by the members of the European Parliament, MEPs, in the European Parliament on 10th of June 2021. the MEPs, the members of the European Parliament, exercise their constitutional rights to raise concerns about certain issues in Sri Lanka based on their own information and understanding. The European Parliament represents the citizens of the EU, which is the only directly elected institution of the EU. So as the elected members of the respective countries to the European Parliament, they have to echo the views of their people, civil society members, NGOs, and other forums. So this is to publicize the issues and bring them to the notice of the Council and the Commission. And the Commission, which is responsible for all matters related to GSP Plus, has its own mechanism. We have to understand this clearly. GSP Plus has its own mechanism. The Commission responded in the Parliament when this resolution was about to be voted. The Commission said that it would take note of these issues under the GSP Plus mechanism. So that was the Commission's response. And since the resolution was not a legislative resolution, the Commission and the Council are not obliged or committed to take any action whatsoever on the basis of information in the resolution. So the Commission will follow the GSP Plus monitoring mechanism and other tools such as joint commission meeting, working groups, and council-appointed working party on GSP Plus for implementation of the GSP Plus. So we need to understand the background in the right context and put that in perspective in terms of the current status of the GSP to Sri Lanka. So therefore, there are no problems. The GSP Plus mechanism is working very well, and we are regularly meeting, and there have not been any serious concerns expressed by the EU on the implementation issue. This is all I have to say on that question.
Thank you, Your Excellency. And there's a question coming from Shehan Samuel, who works in the logistics industry. The question has been directed to the President of the National Chamber of Exporters. And since his background is logistic, he's saying on behalf of the exporters, President, could you tell us, was there a loss last time when Sri Lanka lost GSP Plus, Mr. Ravi Jayawardena?
Thanks, Rohanta, for that question. Simple answer is yes, but long answer is that we took precautions. Let me highlight a few things. We first got the GSP in 1971, July, and it was a 20% discount on import tariffs. Now, vis-a-vis, say, for example, apparel carries a duty of 12% import duty. But with the GSP, it was brought down to 9.6. Vis-a-vis on fish, say tuna, carried a duty of 20%, which was brought down to 17.6. So with that, we did the GSP. Then in 2005, the GSP Plus was introduced, where this so-called the discount was brought down to zero. So there was no... duty whatsoever. So with that, the high fish were directly affected because they were subject to the duty. But on low duty items, they managed to survive, and they continued. So, and also, our exporters, I must say this with all fairness, they did their very best to survive during the period 2009 to 2017 when we lost the GSP Plus totally. We went into what the Madam President said also, was into product innovation, packaging, introducing new products. So we still retain that market share. Not anyone, I'm not too sure, I'm subject to correction. All of us lost the market totally. Yes, we lost a certain percentage, but not the total market. And then we got back the BSP, immediately our volumes went up. So that was the scenario.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Ravi. So Sri Lanka always fights back and wins our consumer back, which is, I think, the power of brand Sri Lanka. I'm going to move to tourism now. And there's a very interesting question coming from one of our tourism students. She's actually based in Seychelles, Ruth. Your Excellency, she's saying, given that Sri Lanka is now an orange country for tourism, how should we proceed on tourism? Over to you, Your Excellency.
Well, the European Council, considering the COVID-19 situation and also on the basis of infection rate, death rate, etc., as against the population of the country, they maintain a list of third countries which are safe for travel based on the epidemiological criteria. The list is being updated every two weeks. This is only an advice without any legal obligation for the EU countries to follow. However, some EU member countries, while taking note of the safe list by the EU, they use color code, the EU and also third countries, as per the level of pandemic situation, deaths per week, infections per week, capacity to control the health crisis, infrastructure availability, etc. They also discourage non-essential visits to third countries. Sri Lanka is not in the safe list of the council. And Belgium has put Sri Lanka in the red zone, not orange, red zone. However, the EU citizens are not prohibited from traveling to red zones. The only hitch is that after visiting a red zone, when they come back, they have to take a PCR and they will have to be on a quarantine program for 10 days. So that is the only measure they have introduced. Other than that, they are allowed to visit zone countries. It is up to the traveler to decide whether to go into a red zone for tourism or not. And having said that, we should also be mindful about the vaccination program in the EU region. Around 68% of the population in Belgium are fully vaccinated. And around 73% have got their first dose. And in the EU, on an average, I think around 63% of the population have been vaccinated. So as far as tourism is concerned, several countries are opening for tourism. Sri Lanka has also made maximum efforts to streamline and simplify the procedures, as Mr. Mahin Karivasam said, without compromising health protocols, and opened all tourist sites for tourists and engaged in tourism promotion in major destination countries. Sri Lanka tourism has not been collectively promoted in the EU region, as maybe because the number of tourists visit from the EU countries vary from one to the other. However, in the EU region, the Ministry of Tourism is in the process of appointing destination representation companies, public relation companies to promote Sri Lanka tourism in Germany, France, Italy, Netherlands, Poland and Sweden. Hope this arrangement will give a boost to Sri Lanka tourism in the EU region. As we expect that once the vaccination drive is completed in Sri Lanka, the pandemic situation will improve within a couple of months. And this gives hope that we can confidently promote winter holidays for tourists from the EU countries to Sri Lanka. Here they plan their holidays about six to eight months in advance. But now we have this pandemic situation, therefore we still have time. Now we are almost in September and we will have to start promoting winter holidays, for which we have a good ground, conducive ground. So therefore, we are in touch with the tourism authorities in Sri Lanka. We are in constant touch. In fact, the Honorable Minister also spoke to us, and we are all geared to promote tourism from this end. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Excellency. And question is coming to Mr. Mahen Karyavasam. It's from one of our students, Sherrod, who first year student of MBA working for Qatar Airways. And he's saying, can we know the real impact of what the country has lost due to tourism? Mahen?
Yes, thank you, Ranta. Well, of course, the real impact is huge. From 2.3 million tourists, we have come down to a mere 17,000 tourists. 2018, we had one of the best years. So the impact is huge, like I mentioned before. Also, it's taking a huge blow on the people working in the trade, directly involved in our trade. So it's a huge impact that we have in our economy, as well as to the society in large.
So, Mahen, what do we do? I mean, what is the industry trying to do now that Her Excellency is saying that, you know, we have to gear ourselves, we'd have to live with COVID, we have to fight and get the European tourists back, because end of the day, European tourists are the people who really give us money. What are the strategies which are there, Mahen?
Like Excellency mentioned, we are in the process of finalizing the global advertising campaign. We have just called for tenders for appointing these PR companies and advertising companies. So I think that project should get off the ground by towards the end of the year, because it's a long process for procurement and so on. So that is a very important step we are taking towards promoting. Then also together with the trade, the DMC, we have launched a tactical program, which is now floated in the market. Sri Lankan Airlines is offering a buy one, get one for a limited period of time. We are also looking at the new markets like Russia, Kazakhstan, Ukraine. I mean, these are the markets that came up during this pandemic times who are still willing to travel to Sri Lanka. So we are doing some promotions on that. On a positive note, we also know that Air France is planning 3 flights a week from November. Edelweiss, which is a part of the Swiss airline, is planning 2 flights a week. So these are all positive points. And also Sri Lankan Airlines is willing to, they're seriously looking at Paris and Frankfurt. They operate now even to Frankfurt at the moment. So these are the positive signs. Well, the second point is the sustainability of people working in the industry. I think this is also a major issue that we are having at the moment. For us to be able to sustain this slowdown that we have been having. So we are working pretty closely with the tourism authorities and the ministry. They have been very helpful. And also the central bank offered us very many moratoriums and concessions. We are looking for credit lines now going forward, because we know that this cannot come back to the picture of 2018 overnight. It's going to take another 2 to 3 years for us to come back to that level.
Thank you, Mahen. Madam, I mean, outstanding career professional in the public sector, 33 years, I mean, unblemished. I mean, we hear so many good things, not only from the private sector, but from your own colleagues who work with you. What is your advice to a youngster studying for the master's, Your Excellency?
I think the postgraduate students are more mature independent and with a vision already as to what to do in their life in terms of their career. Since the job market is very competitive, while pursuing their studies, they should focus on other auxiliary skills and requirements expected in general and also in particular in the chosen fields. We are in a technologically advanced world. We can assume or we can guess as to how the world will transform into in the coming years. Many manual jobs will be replaced. So therefore, as per your career expectations, increase your marketability, employability with additional and right skills, especially leadership skills, IT skills, including emerging digital applications and e-technology, language skills, research capacity, and various other competencies that are required to realize your dream. And I also would like to quote Dr. Abdul Kalam. I really like this quote from him. He said, "Never stop fighting until you arrive at your destined place. That is the unique you. And have an aim in life. Continuously acquire knowledge. Work hard and have the perseverance to realize a great life." So that contains everything required for a postgraduate student or anyone who would like to prosper in life. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Your Excellency. I mean, so true. I yet remember when he stepped out of being the president of India, how he went back in his small car back home, and it was the talk of the world. Ravi, I'd like to turn to you. I mean, the youngsters are studying very hard. They're doing corporate jobs. But then we have come to a situation where we can't even move out because of COVID. I mean, when you were young, studying hard, you know the kind of life that you would live. And given that you're one of the top exporters of Sri Lanka heading NCE, the premier chamber, what is your advice to a youngster who is now stuck at home, working from home, understanding whether there are any career prospects in the next 2 years after studying for the master's? I mean, it's a catch-22. I mean, what is your advice, Ravi?
Rohant, absolutely true. I think say this is the age of maybe about 22, 23. These are the people you're referring to. Am I correct? Right.
Yes, Ravi.
Now, to us also, we also went through something similar, but not bad. In 1971, we faced the first insurrection, JVP insurrection, where we had double session school and then it was reduced to single session. So then I think it went for a long period of time with all the restrictions. And then we came up to 1983, am I correct? The riots came.
Yeah.
So riots came in 83. Again, everything was restricted. Then the war comes in and then the tsunami. So I think we also had gone through lots of challenges. But to the young people, I think the facilities right now. Now, those days, we didn't even have, nor even a television set. So those are the challenges we had. Radio was a luxury when we were going to school. But today, we're talking of internet and all that type of thing. So what I would say is keep on trying and don't give up hope. That's first thing. Secondly, you need to be, I'm quoting this Latin phrase, mens sana in a corpus sano, healthy mind in a healthy body. So you need to keep both your mind and body healthy. Whatever you do, if you allow those two to deteriorate, whatever happens later on in life, you're not going to succeed. You're going to have enormous amount of problems. So keep healthy, do positive things and try to be innovative. That's all I can think of to the young people, because we also went through some of the difficult things. I'm sure, Rohanta, you had the same experience.
I mean, Ravi, you're spot on. I remember when I asked this question from Ijaz Ghani, who was the head of economics in the World Bank in Asia, and he was going to African region. And that was in 2008 when I was head in the Economic Council. I was reporting to Dr. PB, and we had 11 days of money. That's all we had. Right. And a barrel of oil was $150. Yeah, he said, very simply, he said, Rohanta, nothing is going to happen to Sri Lanka. And I said, Professor, you know, you guys are very intelligent people. You know, tell us something more positive. And he took a chart then, and he showed that every time when Sri Lanka was under a severe attack, you know, not knowing where to go, starting from the tsunami, the commodity bubble burst in 2008, you know, the recession in 2011, you know, every time there was always a swing towards the country. And it so happened that, you know, even after 2018 Easter attacks, I mean, Mahen will really say how the country again fought back and got back the tourists. So you're right. You've got to just keep on fighting. And that's exactly what Her Excellency was saying, which is so true. Mahen, what is your advice to a youngster? Because, I mean, end of the day, Mahen, though we talk so much about tourism, today the industry is on the ground. I mean, you have all the hoteliers who are closed up. They have an asset, but they don't have any liquid cash because they are paid up for, you know, the cars. They want to invest in restaurants, and they are in a very bad situation. And, you know, the even the moratorium, end of the day, your interest is calculated back, you know. So things are looking very bleak for the tourist industry. Robin, I think you must be really glad that you're not the president of Slido, because, you know, you'll have to be fighting every day for some kind of concessions from the government. I mean, Mahen, what is your advice to a youngster who is yet having hopes on tourism?
I think, Rohanta, this industry is a great industry and it is going to bounce back. It's not going to be like this every day. I mean, give it another 2 years. 2 to 3 years, and by the time they graduate and they come out, I'm sure there'll be plenty of jobs available in the industry. So this is an industry that's going to grow. If you look at it worldwide, even with UFTA, even with the statistics, it's just a slowdown, let's say. So if you can survive this slowdown, we have survived in the past too, many, many a times during the war times and so on. So I think this is something that's going to bounce back. So I think we should encourage our youngsters to study tourism. Think of new innovative ways of marketing Sri Lanka, digital marketing, new places of interest instead of going every day to Sigiriya Polanaru and Kandy. Perhaps we can do something else. There are some wonderful sites in Sri Lanka which need to be explored. So these are new things that we can do in this country, and this we got a fantastic country here. So there is a lot of potential for tourism, and this is going to bounce back.
Thank you, Mahen. It's very strange you say this, because you know, I do a few guest lectures at Columbia University master's program, and the whole program is full. And sometimes you ask them, why are you studying? And they say, we will fight back. We will come back. And I see this in youngsters, in actual, the what you say just now, Mahen, I see it in the 20, 25-year-olds yet fighting. And, you know, I'm going to turn to Your Excellency. I want to focus a little bit about the COVID, madam. Any learnings from EU on the COVID-19 virus management for the general public? What is your advice, madam? Because you are ahead of the curve, and we are right now, you know, scared. You know, you know, I got enough warnings from my parents when I said I'm going to take this webinar and I'm going to come to office to take it. You know, what is your view?
Well, EU made elaborate arrangements to control the outbreak of COVID-19 in a coordinated manner. And immediately they mobilized the global support to do research on vaccines. And the president of the European Commission has established a coronavirus response team at political level to coordinate the responses, response to the pandemic. And the EU has a huge establishment. They were prepared. They had enough and more resources for them, and also to help the third countries under a support program called Team Europe. And Sri Lanka was also given 22 million euros to address pandemic-related issues last year. And again, last week, the EU has given another 2 million euros to Sri Lanka to help the health sector. The EU is also applying the full flexibility of the EU's fiscal rules to help EU countries to support healthcare systems and businesses in order to keep people in employment during and also after the crisis. The EU state aid rules have been relaxed so that governments can provide liquidity to the economy to support citizens and companies, and also to keep or save all jobs. And the EU addressed all effects of the pandemic on the EU, I would say, community or the countries, including strengthening the public health sector, socio-economic impacts, etc. During the time of crisis across the European Union, in a spirit of solidarity, the EU countries also helped each other. And the most needed ones were given assistance as a priority. So the EU has coordinated a joint effort to secure the production of a sufficient quantity of safe and effective COVID-19 vaccines in the EU through advanced purchase agreements with vaccine producers. And also they set up an EU vaccine sharing mechanism, and also to ensure access to COVID-19 vaccines. Also for low and middle income countries around the world, the EU in the Team Europe approach, you know, there is a support team called Team Europe, which was supporting the third countries. They, through Team Europe, they supported the COVAX Global Vaccine Initiative. So as per the decision of the council, they also designed a common EU digital COVID vaccination certificate to facilitate safe and free movement within the region. And that was very helpful for the EU citizens to travel around, even outside the EU region. And having said that, the pandemic is not over in the EU region, as most countries are classified as red in terms of COVID risks and infection nowadays. Yet they have the required measures to address the crisis and bring it under control. So this is the situation, but you know, we can't draw comparison because it's a huge establishment, 27 countries, but we can learn from the experience what they did. In a smaller way, we can also adapt those procedures and protocols, etc.
Thank you, Your Excellency. Ravi, how do you run your company now? I mean, you have a situation where the COVID percent is like almost 4,000 to 4,500 people are getting COVID, and our death rate is going up to 195, 96. Dr. Nilika says that it might cross 300 in terms of the death rate, and the spread is actually maybe around more than 7,000 to 8,000, unconfirmed. Ravi, how do you run your company?
Rahanta, there are two sides to this question. If your establishment, because since I'm the president, I have to talk about everyone. So I'll wear two caps at this moment of time. It's the large exporter and the small, medium or the small exporter. Now, the large exporter vis-a-vis the garment factories, they have their own transport systems where they pick up the employees, drop them at a place. Even during lockdowns, they do operate. So they run a fairly smooth operation. Sometimes the employees are infected with COVID, then they shut down a particular production line, or otherwise, they shut a production unit and they shift it to someone else, so they do it. But the small and the medium scale exporters are having a serious challenge, because for them, they don't have their own transport systems. So with the shutdowns, the public transport is not operating. So they cannot get their workers to us really struggling, because they have no choice but either to stop operations or just limit it to people who can come on foot. So it's a very, very difficult situation to analyze, especially the SMEs. Some people have 10 employees, 20 employees, 30 employees. Now for them to get organized transport, it's a huge expenditure. And they don't have the facilities to do so. So they have literally shut down. So it's a situation where sometimes, now on the other side, some of the buyers have been quite kind, especially with these SMEs. They have been able to communicate with the buyers and get extensions, because the buyers themselves. Who are actually operating in a niche market found so down. Because in Europe, not everyone goes out. So they also have slow sales. So they don't mind the supplies are delayed a little bit. So because of that, up to now, goodwill, things have worked to some extent. But I know for sure the garment sector are having a serious challenge, because I'm subject to correction. I was told by a leading garment exporter last year, they have to spend something like 3 or 4 million rupees on air freight, because their delivery dates were late. So Rohanta, it's a challenge. It's a challenge, and no one knows when it's going to end.
Thank you, Ravi. Mahen, though we all talk about fantastic practice, end of the day, there's tourists coming from all over the countryside. I mean, there are guys coming from Ukraine, and there are people coming from India. Now the doors are opening up next week. I know that we require the dollars. We have no option, but we know that the pandemic is at its peak, and Delta is only just one. Next might be the Lambda, as they call it. So, Mahen, the question is that, how do you see running tourism with this kind of a pandemic environment?
Rohanta, we are opening to India only for fully vaccinated travelers. So people who have had the double shot and who come in here and they're subject to a PCR, and afterwards they can be in the community. Of course, it's a chance that the people coming in are taking, and that in any country in the world it's the same. I mean, if you take Dubai, if you take the Maldives, I mean, they do the same thing. So if you are to survive in this new norm, I think as long as you take your precautions, you take your precautions with your staff, as long as they are sticking to the safety regulations, I think we should be able to get on with tourism. I think we have to learn to live with it. We have no other choice. So like if you even take Dubai or even Maldives, like I said, it's the same. I mean, they just open even the Maldives. There, of course, it's a different concept in the Maldives. One island, one hotel, it's easy to lock down rather than Sri Lanka. But I think we have to take the chance. We have to see. We need the economy to run. So I think we have to give it a try and see as we go on.
Mahen, just a quick thank you for the initiative you have made with Her Excellency, because in terms of bringing some equipment down to support our medical team. And today in the morning, I discussed with our Rotary COVID Task Force team and had discussions with the Minister of Health also, because we have MOU. And you like to share a few thoughts to the...
Yes, something good that turned out of this while organizing this event Well, that is Excellency told us about this field hospital available in Belgium, which can be sent to Sri Lanka at zero cost. I mean, okay, we got to pay a little bit for the transportation. So it is something that turned out to be good for Sri Lanka. We are very thankful to you, madam, for arranging this. Together with Rotary, I'm sure we can make it a success. And I think Rohanta has fast-tracked it today or immediately. So thank you very much once again. It's a great initiative from you. So we are also contributing in some way to this COVID issue by way of a business council. Thank you.
There are a lot of questions coming in, but because time is not on our side, and I know the team here is very, very high network, high strong policymakers. So I got to call it to a close. But before that, there's one last question that I normally ask, and that happens to be, uh, 19, 20 years back, young Mahen, young Ravi, and the young High, Her Excellency starting work, what advice would you give youngster Ravi, Mr. Ravi Davardhana?
Sorry, Rohanta, I didn't hear your question. There was interruption.
The question is, young Ravi is starting work, 19 years old, Ravi Javardhana, venturing out. What would you advise young Ravi Javardhana today? Same question to Mahen.
Keep up hope and continue to do
good. Sorry, honesty, to be honest and do the correct thing. I think that should be the motive for these youngsters to come, if you are to be successful in life.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Ravi?
Yeah, keep doing good things and be honest. That's basically it.
Your Excellency, your thoughts, madam.
Be honest and chase your dreams. Work hard. So
thank you.
This will take you to your destination.
Thank you very much. So the three top professionals today is just echoing one simple thing. Don't look for short wins. Do the right thing. And I remember that was the same advice that I got from Mahen when I took over tourism. Play straight, play honest, and you'll always be a winner. And I thank you so much for every one of you for sharing a few thoughts to youngsters so that then, you know, this is the only kind of support that we can give a youngster at this moment of time. Thank you very much. And it's been a fantastic discussion. Can I hand over to Kaushali? Over to you, Kaushali.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you very much. And panelists, dear lecturers, dear parents, I would say, and thank you so much for this information sharing session. And definitely to give and impart knowledge, not only that, but to make sure that that experience is shared in a way where all our students and all our viewers will be lining up to be kind and to have that hope, which is quite needed at this point, and to go ahead with their lives as they plan with that dreaming involved. So thank you very much for this informative knowledge sharing session. And thank you so much for coming on board with all of us. And we are proud as APIT family that we could do this change and we could introduce and initiate this change. So this brings us to another end of a session, and we would like to meet you back again in another week. Until then, take care of yourself and good night from Sri Lanka.
Thank you very much. Good night.
Thank you
for having me.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.